Before I begin, you can find a guide on how to body party questions and a text version of the points discussed in the drop box in the description. I don't mean to boast, but when I did this exam 6 years ago I got 98%, so rest assured I am not fucking with your time. This video will go through various points in the ethics syllabus that textbooks might not teach you, and some for philosophy too. In order to body those pesky party questions, you need to examine the views that people hold on a deeper level and see the overall picture, which is no problem because it's easy. To do so, you must recognize that religion is a set of beliefs, and isn't that different from being an environmentalist, feminist, nihilist, or anything else for that matter, and as such groups of people are most definitely not exclusive to religious beliefs. Just don't forget to refer to whichever religion you are asked to. Even past that point, one must realize that an individual can believe absolutely anything they want to, which can include any combination of beliefs. For example, traditional Christianity portrays animals as beings which exist for the use of humans almost solely, even to an extent where humane slaughter of them and their rights in general aren't regarded traditionally. But that doesn't mean you won't find plenty of Christians who believe in all of its principles barring the aforementioned one, who instead believe in animal rights. Hell, you could even get modern Christians who take it a step further and have decided to be vegetarians. You also get fundamentalist and liberal religious views, which I'm sure you already know about. If you want those top grades, it is absolutely vital for you to not only acknowledge the true diversity of groups of people, but the diversity of beliefs within one religion itself. For example, did you know that Hinduism was actually originally a philosophy? And that atheistic Hinduism, despite not being as prevalent as theistic Hinduism nowadays, is totally a thing? Didn't think so, and if you did, shut the fuck up, don't interrupt me. Roles of men and women. Although religion is a good place to start, don't forget about feminists who could. Both feminists believe in equal rights for men and women, although some may believe that a woman can do absolutely anything a man can do, where some believe vice versa simultaneously, and others not so much, whereas some may believe in equal rights nonetheless, but also that men and women are different in some ways and both sexes are better at some things than the other. Civil partnerships. Although views remain divided, some may believe that God still loves his children nonetheless, in spite of scripture, while others may believe that as long as two people give consent, there is nothing sinful about it. Some may believe it is unnatural, while others may argue the opposite, as homosexuality occurs in numerous animal species, particularly in mammals, and even more so in monkeys and primates, which will be taken by those who believe in evolution to be further proof that it is natural. Environmentalists may not view it in a negative light as a result of overpopulation and consumption of the planet. Divorce. Divorce is complicated and can happen for many reasons. Abusive behavior on part of one or more partners, especially dangerous when children are present. Growing apart, or marrying in a rush, both cases of incompatibility, financial troubles. Many more liberal individuals may believe that divorce is inevitable and the right thing to do when abusive behavior takes place, while many believe that it is personal, and divorce even without any pressure from finance or abuse is no problem because the happiness of the individuals is most important, in addition to the fact that inherently there is no immorality or sin in divorce. However, some individuals may believe that even if a father is disruptive and a poor role model without being full-on abusive, it is very important for children to grow up with a father nonetheless. Many will believe that divorce alone, aside from anything related to abuse, adultery, etc., is completely personal. Contraception. In addition to conventional views, many environmentalists, regardless of their religious beliefs, will heavily support contraception due to overpopulation of the planet. Many fundamentalists may believe in the importance of sex being only for reproduction and the value of life. But many liberals may share environmentalist views in addition to it not being feasible for multiple reasons to have so many children, whilst also believing that nonetheless sexual desire is natural and must still be channeled. Abortion. Don't forget that whilst many religious groups view abortion as murder, there are many people who, even without any religious beliefs, will believe the same, Whilst many people who nonetheless believe in religion will believe that it is acceptable or even necessary in some circumstances. Fertility treatment. Similarly, some religious and non-religious people alike will be against fertility treatments which involve third parties such as artificial insemination by donor or egg donation, while many people who have religious beliefs will not be opposed to it, especially if for egg or sperm donation, should the woman be unable to produce eggs or the man sperm, that the donor is a relative of the partner who cannot produce IDD to avoid incest. Suicide. Suicide is a complicated and sensitive issue. Religion and morality aside, individuals who have and haven't been suicidal in the past believe that it is not the way forward, while some may believe that it is one's choice, which includes people who are unfortunately suicidal themselves at the current, although is not limited to them. Illness, injury and euthanasia aside, some may believe that suicide is an acceptable choice to make under a few extreme circumstances such as loss of all family members or financial troubles to the point of having absolutely nothing and not being able to sustain one's quality of life. Some may believe it is wrong or even cowardly and selfish, which is predominantly people who haven't been suicidal before, while others believe that it's a cry for help and extreme emotional distress with the desire to end one's life being no reflection of that individual's character at all. They may also look at suicide from a medical point of view, as depression among other mental health issues can be linked to chemical imbalances in the brain. Some religious believers who are suicidal themselves may believe that God loves them and they won't be judged in the afterlife, or possibly that their God's plan for them was too much to handle. Euthanasia. It is important to know that many believe that if one is in a position where they are on life support for breathing and feeding etc. and show zero improvement after whichever injury or illness put them on it, that they are already dead, and that turning the machine off is not killing them. Others may believe that euthanasia is acceptable if the person survives but is heavily brain damaged to an extent where their quality of life is drastically reduced. Using animals in medical research, some may argue that it is acceptable to test cures on animals for diseases such as cancer, leukemia, etc., even though the pain of the animal involved is undesirable nonetheless. Despite this, many may argue that tests on animals may not always translate to human cures due to obvious anatomical differences, which would make the suffering of the animal unnecessary, which makes testing even more immoral. Typical animals include mice, rats and monkeys. Some may argue that animals don't have the level of consciousness that a human has and have more adrenaline reserves, so feel less pain than a human. But some may counter the argument by stating the animals with the least consciousness, e.g. mice and rats, are less likely to yield a cure which is viable to humans, as the tests or results available may be on genetic mammal cells, while more viable results which can be obtained by testing on monkeys or primates involve more suffering on the animal's part, as it is more intelligent and more conscious, with no guarantee despite the similarity between humans and monkeys/primates. Charities. Some believe that charities are an effective way of dealing with suffering, as it is unknown what such charities will do with your money, whether the monkey they receives actually goes towards a cause, and if it does, whether it is actually effective. Despite this, many religious and non-religious peoples believe in charity as a result of having a responsibility to help those suffering if one is able. War. There is more to war than just beating your opposition. The moral high ground in regards to war includes minimizing the loss of lives of your own soldiers, civilians on either side of the conflict, and even enemy soldiers, i.e. choosing the best means of getting the opposing side to surrender without further fighting. It is also important to ensure that if the defeated enemy side's country experiences a collapse in government of any kind, that the victors ensure that the defeated country is free from anarchy or new corruption. Justice. Although many believe in capital punishment, and many don't, some may believe that some criminals, depending on the nature, scale and circumstances behind their crime, are capable of reformation into useful members of society and can genuinely repent even in cases of murder, particularly manslaughter or accidental murder, etc., particularly in cases of gang culture which involves individuals inducted at a young age due to poverty among other things, where it is not immediately clear that the person is beyond reformation. Although others may genuinely believe it's not worth the risk.
And never meant to kill Trife, Black. And I'm so sorry.
Furthermore, some cases are particularly complicated and verdicts can be subject to change with new evidence, which is another argument against capital punishment. True equality is a relative term, and treating everyone the same is not always treating everyone equally. Obvious example is asking someone with a physical disability to engage in the same kind of activity as people without one. That's just fucked up. At the same time, individuals are exactly that, individuals, and should, whilst being treated equally, be allowed to find and participate in whatever they may be best at, even if that is quite different to the person either side of him. Religion and media, there are numerous sides to this particular argument, all due to the unpredictability of the media. Some may argue that it is good to have their faith represented on television and news to promote diversity and awareness, although others argue the opposite due to the media often producing the opposite result out of lack of understanding or even malice. This can even go on to create tension, hate and even violence between groups, particularly as children and less educated people are particularly susceptible to proclamations of hatred in low or high key. Philosophy, in addition to the beliefs that you are aware of, there are many others you should utilize. Deism is the name given to the belief that a god exists but doesn't interfere. Similarly, some agnostics may acknowledge that there could be a creator, but their inability or lack of will to prevent suffering means they are not worth worshipping as they have no input in their life. Other beliefs may include animism or pantheism, which both believe that there are spiritual qualities to be found within aspects of nature, with pantheists viewing nature itself as an impersonal god. Furthermore, don't forget that many atheists do not believe that there was a god which created the universe, and that the Big Bang and evolution are perfect evidence for the universe and humanity forming by chance, although some may argue that evolution is a natural process and isn't a question of chance. Personal experience can play a large part in belief in life after death, with those who have experienced near-death experiences being prime advocates for this, although some may argue that near-death experiences are hallucinations caused by a lack of oxygen in the brain, but those who have experienced near-death experiences will counter the argument with the occurrence of veridical near-death experiences, which involve the individual observing events taking place outside their body, e.g. exactly what went on in a surgical theater, and accurately verifying those events beforehand, which some may believe is proof that consciousness is not a product of the brain, hence it can exist after death. Despite some may argue that these experiences took place when there was still some oxygen in the brain and that the person wasn't truly dead. There is a lot of dispute over this, with no clear answer. In addition to whatever you have learned about the nature of evil and suffering, Buddhists believe that a large part of suffering caused by desire and that a lot of it has nothing to do with God as it is all part of one's perception. Although others may believe that some desires are innate and cannot be thought away, in which case a lot of suffering is out of one's control, which may lead them back to beliefs about a deity and whether he does or doesn't exist as a result of suffering. Some people may also argue that following religious texts isn't a great source of morality as there are many questionable quotes within many holy books and that many religious leaders and people of influence cherry-pick the best-sounding ones. You'll actually be surprised by how many original points you will come up with in the heat of an exam, although I hope this video broadened your horizons. Good luck, you guys and girls have got this.